Good evening. We're about ready to start the program, so if everyone would find their seats, I appreciate it. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the chapter meeting of the Genesee Valley chapter of the Adirondack Mountain Club. Thanks for coming. I'm Dave Nichols. I'm the vice chair, and I'm filling in for Bill Lindenfelser, who's chair of the chapter. Let's start out the meeting by noticing where all the exits are. There's exits to your right, to the back, and also to your left. Second announcement is please silence your cell phones. That's helpful so it's not distracting you nor your neighbors. We'll get started by having the business part of our meeting. People who are wishing to make announcements are already lining up. So we'll start right off, Peter.
Weeks ago, our chapter was contacted by someone from the Strong Museum in Rochester. Turns out the Strong is going to have some regional theme weekends this summer, and one of them is going to be an Adirondack theme weekend. And they wanted to know if our chapter would like to put on a little display of camping gear and have a presence there. This is the weekend of August 19th and 20th. Well, our chapter leadership, Bill Lindenfelser and others, would very much like to do this and see it as an opportunity to perhaps meet and encourage some younger families to get involved with the Adirondack Mountain Club. The challenge we have is that August 19th and 20th is a long time from now. It's in the middle of summer play season for many of us, and the Strong Museum is asking for a commitment that we will have people there, and we're having a hard time getting people to commit and say, I'll do it that weekend. So what I'm looking for is some volunteers who are pretty sure they're going to be in town August 19th or 20th, not both days, one or the other. And would be willing, it's going to be easy duty, get in free to the Strong Museum, spend a couple hours at a display for Adirondack Mountain Club, maybe answer a few questions about the Adirondacks and the club and give people information and watch the kids crawl in and out of a tent or a canoe or something, and we can help with having that gear there. So if you willing and available, and they'll leave a signed-up clipboard on the table next to the bookstore. Now the challenge is that you're going to be listening to this great program for the next hour, and you're going to have to remember that after the program, go over to the bookstore and sign up on this sheet if you would. Thanks.
Are they providing the equipment that they're showing, or are we supposed to provide?
They are willing to provide equipment.
Next up, Rich.
Thank you. Did everybody have a good time enjoying spring this last weekend? That was it. So, in 60 days, less than 60 days, it'll be time for the Outdoor Expo. And those of you that have been here before know we come up and we ask for volunteers, which is exactly what I'm doing. We're asking for volunteers for people that have friends with kids. We're definitely going to have the petting zoo there, which was, if you were there last year, the petting zoo was not. So we brought them back. I'm up here. If you are considering Peter's suggestion for signing up, the expo is a great training ground. So you can come, sign up. You're going to be there anyhow. What's an extra hour or two? Plus, if you sign up and volunteer, we'll buy you lunch. What a deal. I'm going to pass these around. Please feel free to sign up.
Thanks, Rich. So we have sign up for the expos on the clipboards that are circulating, and then a sign up for the RMSC in August over the Jackson's. So lots of opportunities to sign up. It's strong. My apologies. Sorry. Great.
Greg McGowan, I'm the listening chair for the club, and I just wanted to hold this up for you. Everybody see this? It says ADK GVC. If you are a Facebook user, we have a new Facebook page. Actually, it's not that new, but maybe new to many of you. You can search for this, these two words, and find us on Facebook. We put a lot of information up there about different things that are going on. Wilderness Wednesday post every Wednesday. And that's just something new that we're doing. I wanted to make sure everybody was aware of. The other thing that we're working on is a new website, and anyone who's interested in web technology and making our website better, just find me at some point and let me know. I'd love to have some more volunteers working. Thanks.
Hi, is there a
There is no dash. It's separate.
Okay.
Thanks, Craig. Hi, Ellen.
I have a trip going to Pine Creek, Pennsylvania in 2 weeks, April 21st to Friday through Sunday. We'd be home by Sunday evening. It's for canoes or kayaks, moving water class 1 and 2. I don't have it on the waterways yet, but hope to have that done soon once I send Charlie the information. And if you want more information at the end of the presentation, I'll just stand and be over there somewhere if you want to find me. And the second thing is, in 3 weeks, April 29th, there is a march for clean air and water, and it's happening in DC and around the country and in Rochester. And if you're interested, it's Saturday, April 29th, meeting at 10:30 at the City Hall, and then walking to Washington Park, and it's expected to end about noon. So, thanks.
Thanks, Helen. Jack?
Hi, I'm Jack, Chair of the Conservation Committee. Just a couple things. On April 29th, too, in lieu of going to the march, if you have more energy, we can use some hands helping to pick up the Monroe County parks. We've signed up to host Pick Up the Parks at Webster Park again this year. That starts at 9 a.m. and goes till noon. Details are on the calendar. But we will meet at Parkview Lodge, just off of Hope Road. So if you go on Lake Road and then turn down on Hope Road, it will be just on the west side of Hope Road. The other thing we're doing is on National Trails Day, June 3rd, we will work on the Finger Lakes Trail. And there will be about a mile of new trail to cut into a forever portion of the Finger Lakes Trail. So that'll be a whole day effort on Saturday, June 5th. Keep that in mind.
Thanks, Chad. I have two announcements of my own. I mentioned this last month, but I'm going to mention it again this month. We're moving towards requesting that everybody get their Geneseen via the web, because that helps save our chapter money. It also reduces the amount of paper that we generate and the amount of waste we distribute. So beginning in November with the November 2017 issue, the main distribution, the default distribution of the Geneseen will be by email. Now, if you want to make sure that you get the paper copy, that will still be available, but you're going to have to let us know starting in September that you want the paper copy. If you want to receive the email version, we'd love it if you go online and verify your email address. That way, we can make sure you get it. So, we'll be giving this announcement, obviously, again, with each meeting, but want you to be aware of this. And the next announcement is that we are trying to keep this program, this monthly program at the chapter meetings going, but we need some volunteers. We need your help in putting together the list, the schedule for speakers. So if you enjoy these chapter meeting programs, and I assume that's why you're here, and you want to keep them going forward, please consider contacting Bill Lindenfelser at chair@adk-gvc.org to volunteer to be on the programs committee. And now to introduce our program tonight is Shirley Thomas. Oh, I did it again. You know, I did this last time, and I thought sure that they would kick me out of the chapter for failing to mention that Jackson and the bookstore is important and needs to have that time for the announcement. I've done it again. I think Bill will make sure I don't do these announcements ever again after this. Sorry, Jackson.
Hi, everybody. I know none of you forgot me, right? Chosen the map band. All right, Debbie, thank you very much. Congratulations. Thanks, everybody.
Good evening. I'm here to introduce Ken Harbison, our speaker tonight. Ken joined ADK in 1994 and has been a chapter director, has served on several ADK committees, and was chair of the ADK Fall Outing here in 2004. He has also received the Volunteer Year Award from our chapter. Ken and his wife Judy have climbed 46 high peaks, the Catskill 3500, and the Northeast 111. They have completed the Adirondack Quest, the Fire Tower Challenge, the Northfield Placid Trail, and much of the Finger Lakes Trail. They've also led ADK trips to the high peaks, Catskills, and quest areas. They've hiked in many countries, including Canada, Ireland, the British Isles, Germany, Costa Rica, Peru, Galapagos, and New Zealand. They have visited 48 of the U.S. national parks and many national monuments. Ken's favorite parks are the Grand Canyon and Mount Rainier. Ken has presented numerous ADK programs and workshops, including Outdoor Expo, on backpacking, cooking, the Adirondack Quest, and national parks. You can even find some of Ken's backpacking recipes on our website. Tonight, Ken is presenting Costa Rica, a multi-sport adventure. Please join me in welcoming Ken Harbison.
Sure. First off, I'd like to thank Joanne Mitchell, who got us involved with ADK. It's certainly been a wonderful experience for us. So, we're talking about the Rhodes Scholar trip called River to Shore, multi-sport adventure.
We've got to get this microphone on.
So, Costa Rica, a small country.
Louder!
Okay. A small country that's smaller than West Virginia, somewhat the size of Switzerland, actually, approaching 5 million people. The literacy rate is the highest in South America and Central America, 90%. So this was our route. So it's Rim of the Caribbean. To the shore of the Pacific. It was a scheduled 11-day trip. And you notice the green there. Those are the national parks in Costa Rica. 26% of the country is national parks or nature reserves. So that's one of the highest in the world. So we started in San Jose. And this was the kind of a central park right across from our hotel, big soccer stadium. It used to be the airport, but of course with travel they had to move it out of the town. But a very modern city, as you can see. We went a day early, arranged through Rhodes Scholar. One reason was to be sure that we got there and didn't miss the road trip or anything, if we had any problems with connections. But also I wanted to go to this renowned butterfly garden. So here's a sort of tropical garden. And this is this orchid is the national flower of Costa Rica. And they raise the butterflies there, often getting the new chrysalises twice a week. So here's one of the beautiful ones there, malachite. There are over 1,250 species of butterflies in Costa Rica. That's approaching twice what it is in the U.S., including Puerto Rico and Hawaii. Here's a pair of thoas, swallowtails, mating. They do it on the bottom side of a large leaf as for protection. And on the right there is the caterpillar for it, and you notice it looks very much like bird rides, part of the defensive mechanism. This is the largest butterfly in Costa Rica. It's a fully 7 inches across. Because of the eye spot on the underside of the wing, and the look on the right, that's the caterpillar, which looks very much like a piece of plant tissue. Again, very defensive style for the caterpillar. So this was a Rhodes Scholar trip, and an important part of all of the Rhodes Scholars is education. There were 5 evening presentations, and we also had salsas. First, we'll talk about it in just a second. It's on the Blue Zone. It's where people around the world live to high age, many more than 100 years old. And then history, and in particular biology and threats to the wildlife. Here was our leader, Judy, and he's a photographer for National Geographic, very skilled, and you can see the equipment that he has. His birding camera is impressive. Here he is with his girlfriend Alexis, and she was the one who led the or taught the salsa lessons. So the Blue Zones. There's a series of books on, or editions on them. So where people live to a high age. And there are 5 locations in the world that are identified, and Nicoya in Costa Rica is an area for which it was identified. Here's Don Faustino Vargas, and he celebrated his 111th birthday. I haven't found an obituary. He's not alive now, I'm certain. But there were a number of factors that were considered common to these areas where people lived to great age. Strong social connections, family, friends, important. Sense of purpose. He really ran the family. There's 5 generations that lived together. And he cooks a Sunday dinner. Diet's important, and physical activity. In the part of the mountainous region, people don't have cars, tractors minimal, so people get out and they walk every day and to meet people in sloping terrain. For food, it's rather limited in meat. They do eat some meat, but it's fruits and vegetables are the dominant part. So this is a typical lunch in the Nicoya. Okay, so our second day on the tour was to go to the Poas Volcano. Here it is as we came up onto the rim. You see that it was some steam. But then right while we were there, there was like, I guess you'd call it a geyser. So this is the world's 7th largest crater. It's kind of continuously active with steam eruptions. Gets going, and finally it reached us. The clouds reached us on the rim, which is something like 800 feet above the lake there. The bottom of the lake is liquid sulfur, and there's a warning sign on it: don't stay there too long. It's not sulfur dioxide, but it can be harmful. It's acidic vapors. And there was an occasional explosion, which is what made the cone in the bottom of the crater spectacular. And nearby is another crater, now extinct, or probably extinct. And right in the foreground is what's called Poor Man's Umbrella. Huge leaves, 4 to 6 feet across. And this is a cloud forest right around it, and bromeliads, a great variety of things growing in this high humidity region. Part of that day's tour was to visit coffee plantation. Coffee being a very important export from Costa Rica. Here was our perky guide explaining everything, letting us sample. is a traditional cart that was used to carry the bagged coffee beans to the market and for export. And now the mixing is done by the visitors. So this, they're spread out, and then they need to be stirred, and so there's Judy. So here's a Poas swallowtail. There was a butterfly garden there. And here's the pelican flower that's in the garden. And it's about 12 inches, but the grid there is 20 centimeters or 8 inches. So it's about 12 inches high. It's Aristolochia, but like Dutchman's pipe. It's a poisonous plant. The caterpillar of the Polydamas swallowtail feeds on it, becomes poisonous. And as a warning to birds, well, it's red and spiky. It's something it's saying, don't eat me. And then here's the adult in the bottom. Day three, we went over to the Caribbean coast. And the part in blue is where we are. We're on a motor launch because there are no roads going into the park there. On the way, where the bus parked, was a kapok tree. Kapok used to be used in things like sleeping bags, and it still is used for some items. And the tree is huge, the size of that. We saw our first poison dart frog. They're about a half an inch to maybe 2 inches. Quite small, sometimes hard to find. So this is a red and black one. And a three-toed sloth slowly moving down the tree. Because there are no roads, we went by a launch into the Tortuguero National Park. And on the way, very soon, we saw these nests hanging in the trees, or pendula. They are relatives of the Baltimore oriole. And in fact, Baltimore orioles winter in Costa Rica and in Central America. And here's from the web of a picture of a tree in which both an orpendula and Baltimore oriole have their nest. You can see that the orpendula is about three times bigger than a Baltimore oriole. We saw 88 species of birds. Now, if you go on a birding trip, you can probably see 300 of them. But this is our trip is the multi-sport adventure was a certain important part of it. So tiger heron, and we saw a little blue heron. Now, the one on the right is not my picture. We bought a CD from one of the guides of pictures that they've taken from other trips. And so when I use one of his pictures, it says Natura somewhere in the bottom. And you will notice that most of the pictures are very professional, very shallow depth of field to emphasize the creature that's there, the bird that's there. Here are some long-nosed sapling bats. And you see they're in a line. If they feel threatened or something, they move back and forth to try to simulate a snake. Snowy egrets, we saw a lot of egrets. Beautiful birds there. And that's in the wake of the boat, of the launch. Our first basilisk lizard. We'll see more of that in a minute. Howler monkeys. And where we stayed, there were many howler monkeys. A few this is where the turtles lay their eggs. The beach is there. We were not at peak turtle season. We saw only one turtle. But here's the schedule. So the red is for the Caribbean, and in particular, the green turtles, they nest in our summer, and then in June up to September. And the Rhodes Scholar trips that are there generally have a night walk to see the turtles. The green is on the Pacific coast. So this was our Echo Lodge there. Nice facilities, fishing with skylights, etc. And this was the turtle-shaped pool. This is what greeted us in our room. Isn't that clever artwork? Howler monkeys. Every morning, 5:15, they started howling. And some of them would run across the roof. Just on schedule. So, the morning then we went on a kayak trip. I should point out there was another, we had a small group, a group of five. And there was another group that had started the day before on a program which they call the Best of Costa Rica, Nature's Wonders. And it was kind of a similar trip, except that they did not do any kayaking. So we saw things via the kayak at our own pace. Crocodile came out, was like second in a fight. Black River turtles, we saw several of those. Green pause, we saw them at a distance. This is a very endangered species. There's only 35 breeding pairs left in Costa Rica. And it feeds almost entirely on almonds. And the reason there's so few, it's the pet trade. Anhinga, saw anhingas. The one on the left, he never turned around so that I could see him in his full glory. But so here's one of the pictures from the guy. So this was like this. The river here then was open with a tall rainforest there, very very tall, with animals and particularly the monkeys in the trees. But since we were on kayaks, we could go into these little creeks in the side and see many things. People that the other tour that were going by launch, of course, couldn't get into these places. So, more egrets. You see our eyes? And particularly on the left, just buried in the shrubbery. Green iguana, spider monkeys, they held a large group and they were all around. And this one was jumping across the river, so I should just barely catch him in flight. This fruit is called a monkey comb. Spiny and full of seeds, of course. And there are wild orchids around, so there are 1,400 wild orchid species in Costa Rica. Day five, so we traced our steps back and then went to Sarapiqui. So on the way back, here's the spectacle of caiman that allowed themselves to be photographed at pretty close. And the basilisk. Now let's see if this works. Yeah.
jungles of Costa Rica. Speed is everything for the basilisk lizard. When you prey on winged insects, you need to be quick, because your prey moves fast, really fast. So when the basilisk is in a hurry, it displays one of the most spectacular capabilities in nature. A true superpower. This flat-footed reptile is so fast and so light that it can run across the surface of the water at speeds as much as 5 feet per second. But speed alone doesn't make this superpower possible. Long toes on their rear feet, along with fringes of skin that unfurl to meet the water, create little air pockets under the lizard's feet, and the air pockets give the lizard lift. A true superpower in nature.
Isn't that something? So, all that activity was in slow motion, because there was just no chance that I could have gotten out of the picture. It was only just in a couple seconds. As I said, 5 feet a second, they run on water. Here's a baby alligator. Judy saw an osprey, and this is a picture taken by our leader, Judy. So you can see it's National Geographic quality from him. He shared several of his pictures. So that day we traveled to this reserve, in Bio Reserve. And part of the area is a demonstration of a chocolate history and manufacture. So this is the flour from which chocolate is made. You see it's on the trunk or on a branch, not on a limb, but not at the end of a limb as most plants are. Just right on the trunk. And that's the fruit that has the beans in it. And it was participation by this make chocolate by the traditional method and share the results. And a family of Judy's came by and kind of watched us. So this is where we stayed, the lodge that is right at the edge of this bioreserve. And it was a lovely place, beautiful wood there. All elevated, and you can see the water there. This little orb spider was kind of almost outside our room. It's a gorgeous creature. And there was a porcupine, so I caught it on the left, and our leader got this close up because the porcupine went right close to his room, so he took this from his room. We went out early in the morning before breakfast on bird walks. We did that actually several times. So here are some serious birders. And here are a couple that we saw. As we saw them, they were way up in the trees and no chance of getting a good picture, but they're colorful. The one on the left is the national bird of Costa Rica. Or a pendula nest, or across the way, and you see the cylinder down the bottom is a nesting box for macaws, secure against someone getting into it, and hoping that they would nest there. At the time, it was empty. They fed the or pendulas after breakfast, left over food for them. And we went on a frog walk, so more poison dart frogs. These are green and black, poison lowlands and dart frogs. And this was kind of everybody's favorite. It's called the Blue James frog. The official name is the strawberry poison dart frog. So then there are hanging bridges to get into the bioreserve, and that puts you in with the in the foliage, see some things through it and above it. Here was one of the interesting plants, known locally as hot lips. And somebody put a hot lip inside this. This is a monkey pot. It's a seed pod from it. This is a close relative of the Brazil nuts that we know. And rice on the ground, the top gets knocked off of it to release the seeds. You don't want to be standing under it. So here's our leader, and looking up at the trees, at the birds that are there. Stairs that we had to climb. Voice is important. Bullet ants. We were warned against the bullet. Do not brush against the foliage because they have really, really powerful bites, and they will attack you if you brush against the branches that they're on. Leaf cutter ants. They were running. This is along the rail of the stairs, and here's the insert is from our leader, close up of an ant. And from our daughter, here's a picture of what they can do to a plant. They can just strip a leaf entirely. Notice several of them have no leaves left on. This is the direction to largest almond tree, and here it is. It's 46 feet in diameter and 117 feet high. It's hollow, and there are white lined bats inside of it. So, back. So this is crossing the Sarapiqui River. More hanging bridges. And speaking of the Sarapiqui, part of this of the tour was to go rafting on the Sarapiqui. And so this is a group of five of us and two guides, and we were told to paddle. Going into our paddle as hard as you can in order to clear the rapid, and if we hit a rock that you can get past it. As you can see from the lower right, this was in the dry season, and so the river was not as high as it might be during the peak of the wet season. But plenty of a chance to get wet. And here's another one. So really dig in here. And at the end, we get the high five. Everybody had a good time. So then from Missouri, we cross the center of the country. The center of the country is a line of volcanoes, so it's high, and it's very young, just a few million years old. So it's very rough terrain, and we're headed over then to the Pacific coast. And on the way, well, some of the agriculture is very important, very important exports. Here's a banana plantation. Notice the blue bags. Part of it is to keep the birds from pecking on them, but more importantly, this prevents the seeds from falling, prevents the insects to get to it, because Americans don't like seedy bananas. Here's a fern farm, so this goes to florists in the U.S., shaded, large scale. Here's a small coffee plantation, so the small shrubs are the coffee plants. The trees are legumes, so they feed it naturally with nitrogen from fixing nitrogen. And they also provide shade, which makes for a little bit better quality of coffee. Hummingbirds, there's 54 species of hummingbirds in Costa Rica. Because it's mountainous, we have waterfalls, so here's a 300-footer called Angel's Falls. Another one along the road. Here's there were a number of places that were living fences where people would just put a post in the ground and would sprout, and they would trim it. The limbo tree, and it's known as the tourist tree because of the peeling bark. One of the activities then was the zip line, so here's Judy heading down. So big, these heavy leather gloves are the brakes for it. And she comes into the next station, and there's a huge bumper there. So if you haven't controlled the speed very well, at least you're not going to be hurt when you stop. And then transfer to the next section of the zip line. So heading off into the forest and above it. And there, okay. So the longest run is 2,400 feet. We were told to break when you go over the red building, because one could get to 50 miles an hour on this long stretch. So our last place that we stayed, other than just prepare for the plane, is this resort, and it's inside of a 750-acre reserve, bioreserve. A lovely place. There are three pools, and also it's right by a nice white sand beach. And there are wildlife all through the building. So here's the great Kiskadee, actually living on the eave of the house, kind of just almost next to us. And the portrait, you can see what it looks like better. Iguanas is walking around on the walkways. A number of water Mondays look the part, looking for handouts. Mangrove black hawks. And you saw a pale little woodpecker. Scarlet macaws, and there was an evening presentation. This is another one of the parrot species that's on the endangered species list, and the threat is from illegal trapping for the pet trade. They live in the wild, they live more than 4 years typically. In captivity, they can live 75 years. They mate for life. This was taken by our daughter on a separate trip. And here's a nest in a hollow on a peacock tree, and this is right across from the hotel in this resort, so some of the people can see it directly from their rooms. There are at least five macaw nests in the area. Chestnut mandible toucan, and this is the fruit that they love, and so other birds too, but it's toxic, somewhat toxic. So what they do after eating this, what they do is they go to some place like a riverbank and eat some wet clay, and the clay then absorbs the toxin, and they're more harmed. There was a butterfly garden there too. And here's the blue morpho. So this is the signature butterfly of Costa Rica that feeds primarily on is, the egg with the red arrow, and then there are three instars of the morpho caterpillars. And we went on a tour on the Tarcoles River, also known as Crocodile River. There are 2,000 crocodiles on this river. This one, some of the big ones are named, the ones that are kind of resident and predictable. Now this one is not, it's known as Osama bin Laden, it's a 16-footer. If you go on a bus tour, the bus driver will stop on this bridge and you look over and you're guaranteed to see crocodiles there because the bus drivers throw over chicken parts. So there we'll get this resident population. Rely on them. For the other tours, some of the get closely involved. We began feeding chicken parts. Lovely green iguana was on the shore. Egrets. Mangrove swallows, they were kind of dive bombing our boat, many of them, but sweeping along the side, kind of following us. Mimbrel. And Carara. It's a falcon family, and look at the claws on it. It's like a large chicken, but it's really powerful claws. Not your most beautiful heron, but you will notice that the female there is on the nest has a baby with it. It's hatchling. So part of the tour was to go to an isolated beach. Now we had a choice. Don't have pictures because we put away our cameras into the dry bag. Had a choice between outriggers, where all of us would be together, or we could have the individual kayaks. And we chose to do the kayaks for this. So this was the beach, so not easily accessible by road, no direct roads. So people mostly came in by boat. And our guide, found some sea creatures, a sea cucumber. Real star. And the beach had many ghost crabs. As you approach them, they would run away and then duck down into their holes. Fun to watch. Overhead, there were dozens of magnificent frigate birds. Their wingspan is about 8 feet. So, and a group of them is called a flotilla. So there were far more than that just kept coming. Really spectacular. Okay, back across the country to get to San Jose, 10. And, well, they had a kind of special, we went to a spa. Yes. So this is a hot pool in the back, cold pool in the front. And here was the Turkish steam room. Outside, went through that cycle a couple of times. And now I'm going to end with a beautiful blue morpho. Okay, that was all. Darts and arrows, if they're willing to lift it up, and I've seen other pictures, so apparently it's not entirely safe to do it.
Do we have a handle on the pet area in Costa Rica, or is it still a big problem?
It is still a big problem, but you can see that there were some things that were precautions that are taken, but it is so easy to track, because it's in the wild, it's so easy to trace down and capture the birds of all sorts. There's a huge market, in particularly the parrot species, for the macaws, a huge market in the U.S. and Europe, and especially Japan.
Are you threatened by the crocodiles when you're kayaking?
Well, we were 10 feet away. Some of the birds are different.